good to be here, and great to meet you all. Before some of the later arrivals came in, everyone introduced themselves, and we have a nice mix of folks, and probably just keep going now since we're taping this. Sumi asked me to talk about dual use and gain of function challenges, and I'm very interested in regulation. My sense is that it's easiest for politicians to just layer on regulations when they're concerned about safety or concerned about security. And so I'll talk about some of that history that has occurred starting back in the 90s. I got involved in biodefense in 1987 when I moved to USAMRIID, and actually you were talking about the toxin lectures that you're having. I was responsible for the toxin defense program at USAMRIID. We no longer had an offensive program then. That stopped in 1969. Actually, President Nixon went to Fort Detrick at Frederick and made the announcement that we were going to stop making biological weapons, and we did. What I'm going to do, and this is a brand new slide, I was just showing it to Sumi right before we started. I'm going to cover this space, but a step at a time. And you don't have to worry about this right now, but what I've found is that here's the U.S. offensive program ending. We were interested in laboratory safety all those years. We didn't even talk about laboratory security until Larry Wayne Harris in 1996. We didn't have guns, gates, and guards around our high containment laboratories. And then he came along, and I'll tell you a little bit about that. And then we drifted into, and eventually after 9/11 and the anthrax letters, thought about laboratory security almost more than safety. And now, frankly, I think we're drifting back to safety if you just kind of synthesize all the noise in this whole process. I think we're drifting back more to safety than security. And we're thinking not just laboratory safety, but community safety as well. Unfortunately, what has occurred as a result of a lot of little missteps, often by individuals, not by organizations, is a layering of regulations. I call it the hyper-regulation of research. And I think all those things are having an effect on productivity. And I think at the same time, the local leadership has lost, its authority has been taken away from it in many cases. Leadership in government labs doesn't have the authority and the responsibility package that I had. When I became commander, the general I was working for put his arm around me and said, "Dave, you're the expert here in this lab. You run it the way you want to run it, and come to me if you have any questions." You couldn't ask for a better boss than that, and that's the kind of boss I had. So I, of course, felt very responsible, totally responsible for anything bad that might happen in that lab, but also for making good things come out of the lab. And I don't think our commanders today have that same opportunity. They often are just pecked to death by ducks, by people from inside the Beltway, often a bureaucracy. Not solid leaders above them. And up above that, international programs, when I got started, we were in a Cold War biodefense program. The Soviets were the guys we were worried about. And then after the Soviet Union fell, the Nunn-Lugar program, some of you have heard about, I call that true CTR, where we were really doing that. Then we went into what I call a period of confusion, where we didn't have any weapons programs to shut down, so we tried to secure everything else, good stuff. And now we're moved into an area that is called global health security, which is what the name of this course is, which to me looks like a better direction than where we were 10 years ago. So let's get started on this. Anyone know what this slide is? Or what it represents? It's both sexes, life expectancy in the United States. What's this, for Pete's sake? Yeah, it is. And that, I think, is a really nice representation of the power of nature. Joshua Lederberg, a Nobel laureate who used to carry this around with him all the time, said, "Eventually the viruses are going to win." You know, But I think this upward slope is a reflection of the power of biotechnology and the power of what people have done. People like Maurice Hilleman, who came out of Walter Reed after World War II and went to Merck, developed most of the childhood vaccines that all of us took, who have saved millions and millions of lives. He did that with pretty simple technology. Today we have much better tools to produce the flu vaccine that you guys were talking about before the class is done with better tools. There are new recombinant hepatitis vaccines and so on. So I see that upward slope as a reflection of what technologies have done for us. Have anyone ever heard of Matthew Meselson from Harvard? He's a pretty senior guy by now. I think he's up in his high 80s and still has a working laboratory, a microbiologist. He said in 1999, every major technology has been extensively exploited, not only for peaceful purposes, but also for hostile ones. Then he asked the question, must this also happen with biotechnology, certain to be the dominant technology of the 21st century? I think a really good question, and I'm sure Matt is sitting back and watching as we've gone through the issues now with dual use, with gain of function that we're facing, and so on. And I think that was a prophetic statement. Even in the popular media, Wired, which is kind of an eccentric, forward-leaning science magazine, scientists know how to turn a chicken into a dinosaur. What could possibly go wrong? And you know, we're about there. For many years, as I said earlier, now we're way back here on that other chart, it was all about biosafety. In fact, as late as 98, if you had come to my laboratory, USAMRID, and had a briefing, I would have said my three top priorities in this lab are safety, safety, and safety. It was a BL4 lab, and I had people in harm's way every day where a needle stick, a monkey bite, a bone fragment through a pathologist's glove could kill them. And so you have to make safety a very high priority, and it was. For me, I was fortunate that I had a wonderful safety officer who was not a box-checking, sharp pencil guy who would say, you can't do that, you can't do that, you can't do that. He was the kind of guy that would walk into your lab and say, let's work together to see how we can accomplish what you want to accomplish as efficiently as and safely as possible. Some of you probably heard of Bob Hawley. He's a former president of ABSA and still around and semi-active. That was Bob. I was really fortunate to have him as my safety officer. But the boss has to support that as well. If I blew off safety and said it's Bob's problem, the scientists probably wouldn't have listened as carefully to Bob as they did. So that's the kind of thing I was talking about when I mentioned that leadership is important. Then something that happened actually not too far from here. We were talking about the campus over in, where's that other campus we were talking about earlier where the BL3 lab is? GMU campus? Yeah. What? Manassas, right. Right near there is the American Type Culture Collection. I don't know if you've ever driven by that place. But what that is essentially a laboratory that has culture isolate samples of all kinds of bugs. Viruses, bacteria, and probably prions, things like that as well. This guy, Larry Wayne Harris, forged some stationery. He was from Columbus, Ohio, I think. He forged some stationery, wrote to the American Type Culture Collection, and asked for some plague, Yersinia pestis, bacillus. And I don't think we ever found out exactly what he was going to do with it, but the FBI believed he was going to do mischief with it. And they arrested him, and he was given 200 hours of community service because there were no laws at that time against misuse of biological materials, which is, we've come a long way since then. But that was 97. He got 200 hours of community service, and we got the select agent rule. I know it shut down RID for about 3 months until the CDC could come inspect us and give us a check in the box that said we can hold a certain group of agents and we can transfer agents. At that time in 97, there was no registration of or background checks on humans. It was just, it allowed us to transfer agents between other labs that had a select agent approval. Then after 9/11 and 10/4, the anthrax letters, we got the USA Patriot Act and a second layer of select agent regulation. In this case, they added registration of people that might work with select agents and FBI background checks and so on. And that still exists today, although the bureaucracy around that has grown enormously in the last few years. So then we come to this concept of dual-use research of concern. I had never heard of it before serving on this committee at the National Academies. It was called the Fink Committee, or the Fink Report, Biotechnology Research in an Age of Terrorism. And it was done because the National Academies of Science, I think someone there with some wisdom, saw that we're headed down a road here that we better take a look at before we travel down it. We had just had 9/11, we had had 10/4. Earlier we'd had, and I'm sure you've all heard about the IL-4 mousepox story in Australia, we'd also had the second de novo synthesis of poliovirus by someone named Wimmer. And then there was a particular pathogenic factor in orthopox viruses that was found that was in smallpox that you could put into the other, some camelpox or sheeppox, and probably make those very much like smallpox. And so all those things had occurred. In addition, we had just dumped $6 billion annually into our biodefense budget in DOD, but particularly in HHS and DHS as well to some degree. In 1997, just a few years before, the total budget for biodefense in the United States for S&T was $137 million with an M. It jumped to $6 billion annually with a B. So we had a lot more people working with select agents. So the Academy said, we better look at this concept of harm coming out of good laboratories. And that's essentially what the Fink Report was. And we concluded that more good than harm will come, that we need these technologies, we've got to have them for the future. We must balance regulation and progress. Boy, I'd like to hear someone say that today. The playing field is international, and the best way to deal with this is through education and awareness in our scientific community and in the public. All those things sound good. They recommended an unnamed organization at that time, which became the NSABB, and it was to bring together science and security. In the past, we had always brought together nuclear science and security, but we'd never done this with biological science and security, so that was the recommendation. NSAB was formed, and suddenly we went from thinking about laboratory safety, which is where I had grown up, to thinking more about security in our labs. We came up with, because dual use is hard to describe, if someone asks you what does dual use mean and so on, it's probably easier to give examples. And we came up with these things called experiments of concern. We didn't say you can't do these things, but we said before you do these things, you should think about it and make sure that you want to do it and that you can control the outcome and you have some sense of what the outcomes might be. And so there were things like making a vaccine ineffective. There are times when you might want to do that in research to study something, pathogenesis or whatever. Increasing the transmissibility of a pathogen or changing the host range of a pathogen. Taking something like foot and mouth disease that is just in cloven-hoofed animals virus and put it into some other species. You need to really think about the long-term outcome of those kinds of things. So they became known as the seven deadly sins. I have come up with an eighth deadly sin, which I think we did, and a pretty important one. We called it dual-use research of concern, which has made us focus on the technologies and on the science at the bench. I think we might have been better off calling it responsible life science research and focus on the frontal lobe of the scientist. It'd be a little harder to do, but that's really where the issues are, typically. It's not that this stuff is dangerous, it's what this guy does with it that becomes potentially dangerous. So I don't think what I'm suggesting is practical, but I think it's a way of thinking about how to deal with dual use. One of the early tasks we had as a NSABB was when Peter Pelosi and Jeff Taubenberger et al. Sequenced the 1918 flu, and they were getting ready to publish it. The editors sent it to us, and we reviewed it and thought about it at some length. I remember we had a whole series of conference calls about this. Should it be published, or will someone then take that sequence and release the flu? We got flu experts in and talked about what would happen today, where we have a lot of N1, all of us have a lot of N1 immunity, so maybe it wouldn't be as bad, and so on. And I think my conclusion after all that, and we approved it, and they were published. One of my major conclusions was, if we publish it, the best scientists globally will have an opportunity to find a solution to any potential dangers. And that's sort of how I feel about a lot of science. I think there's some science that's probably too dangerous to do, but it's really hard to put a lid on something once it's been published. And if you can get it out to good people, there are more good people than bad people working in biology. And I like the idea of letting the good people try to solve the problems. We went on to make a number of reports at the NSABB, and one of them, the most important one, was in 07, Proposed Framework for Oversight of Dual-Use Life Sciences Research Strategies for Minimizing a Potential Misuse of Research Information. And some of you have probably seen that one in your travels in this area. I'll come back to that in a minute. I'm trying to do this chronologically. Then in August 2 of 08, in our hometown newspaper, we had this very sad, for me, headline. Bruce Ivins had committed suicide. Here's Fort Detrick. That was my office right there. Bruce was somebody we all knew well. I can answer questions about that later. I'm still not totally convinced he did it. I always say I'm 80% there. The circumstantial evidence was overwhelming that he did it. But the FBI clearly did not prove that he did it. And I don't think it would have stood up in court. But again, circumstantial evidence was overwhelming in many ways. So he may have. Big blow to the lab, big blow to a lot of scientists. There are many who work closely with him who still believe he didn't do it. The political community responded quickly. That was August 2. This is August 8. Dingell and Stupak, two congressmen, who said, if these allegations are true, it's about the FBI, about Bruce. The FBI has identified serious weaknesses in the security at one of our nation's premier laboratories for the study of some of the most deadly pathogens in the world. Their allegations also raise equally troubling security concerns about thousands of other scientists technicians who work in hundreds of labs with select biological agents. So waving a red flag and saying, we've got to do something about this. This is going to be dangerous. At the same time, just coincidentally, there was a study that was going on called World at Risk. And I think this was by Bob Graham and Talent, Graham and Talent. I can't think of Talent's first name. Senator? Jim Talent, yeah. just happened to be going on. And one of their conclusions was that we should be less concerned that terrorists will become biologists and far more concerned that biologists will become terrorists. So I think they were influenced by what was going on around them, obviously. We started regulating. The DOD had been working on AR-50-1. In fact, they'd implemented a draft version of AR-50-1 in 2004, 4 years before. But strangely, it was signed, I think, a week before Bruce died. It was signed. It just happened that they did. And this was a surety reg. In the past, we had obviously safety regulations. But this really overlaid a nuclear model on biology. We had used surety in our personnel reliability in our chemical programs. I had worked at the Institute of Chemical Defense in the early 80 to 84, and I was in a surety program there where they look at, for are you mentally alert, emotionally stable, trustworthy, and so on. And there's a big sticker on your medical records in the military that says you're in a surety program and your docs should be watching you to see if there's anything unusual. So safety we all love and care about. Physical security is fine. Scientists don't care if they have to go through a gate or fences or have cameras in their labs. Agent accountability proved to be impossible to implement, because with replicating agents for which you don't have good measuring devices like you do for chemicals or radiological materials, it's hard to do. Although there's still a level of agent accountability, it's not as stringent as it was when they first implemented it, because it just shut down the labs. And then, of course, personal reliability. So initially that was just DOD, and then it was DOD contractors. And I don't know how we define what everyone who works with select agents do today, but it's I think it's pretty close to that. At the same time, in 2008, there were four studies done looking at this issue of security in labs and so on. And I served on two of these, those first two. This was an all-government study, and this was an academy study. And they all looked or mentioned the importance of having thinking about the culture in organizations. In some cases, it was just sort of a tagged on at the end, but every one of the studies mentioned that we should look at leadership or culture, and oh, here it is, leadership or culture in organizations. We've done very little of that. If you look carefully at what our regulations have done, what our laws have done, what we've implemented, I actually think we've gone the other way, at least in DOD labs. We no longer have experts as commanders of our labs. We bring in people who, the last three commanders of USAMRIT have never worked in a lab before. Three ago, it was just a hospital hospital commander, and the one that just left was a special ops doc from SOCOM most of his career, and the current one, I think, is a medical service corps something, but they haven't worked in labs. And it just doesn't make sense to me. Then we jump from those issues to another task for the NSABB. NIH funded Ron Fouché and Yoshi Karioka to take H5N1, let me jump back. You know, in 09, we had an H1N1 outbreak that ripped through the world. It was first diagnosed in a Navy lab, I think, down in California, and as it came across the border, and it just engulfed the world in months, probably, but it transmitted from person to person, but it was not very virulent at all. Then we had H5N1 in chickens, which was transmitted quickly in chickens, but very poorly in people. If you were a little child sleeping with a chicken in China or something, you might you might get the disease, and a few people died. Many of the people who got a high percentage, 50% or more of the people who contracted the virus did die. So it was lethal if you got it, but it didn't transmit human to human well at all. The NIH asked these two guys to develop an H5 virus that would be transmissible in mammals. And the model is ferrets, typically. That's the best animal model for flu. So they did it, and they succeeded. They sent one, he sent his paper to Science, and Yoshi sent his paper to Nature. And the editors, again, sent those to the NSABB and said, should we publish this? This looks like it could be dangerous. Because they were the sequence changes that they had to put into the virus in order to make it transmissible. And we jumped through a lot of hoops. We saw it first and were concerned. Then there was a WHO meeting with experts from, I think, 13, flu experts from 13 different countries. Then it came back to us, and eventually we did approve it. And then the material was published. But it caused an enormous amount of turmoil in the science community. Really good scientists, I have dear friends on both sides, really good people who disagreed on whether that should have been done and whether it should have been published. But again, one of the problems in a free society, or maybe it's one of the blessings of a free society, is that you can't put a lid on research that comes out of academe in the U.S. It has to be born secret. If you want to do secret research, you need to do it in a Department of Energy lab or a DOD lab or some lab where it can be kept secret. And we just don't operate like that in academe. So it essentially had to be published. In the end, I believe the author's behavior, and that's a plural possessive, not just Ron, who was the most outspoken, but I think both of them, personal opinion, was more disruptive than the science. And if we could have just slid those under the radar and published them, it probably would have been better for security and better for safety than what really happened. Ron had said, this is very bad news, as efficiently transmitted as seasonal virus, probably one of the most dangerous viruses you can make. And everybody's ears perked up, boy, what's going on here? And I think it would have been better, as I say, if we had just published them. So that whole experience, I think, was not good for science in the U.S. Necessarily, because there are people that are still upset about, some say, you shouldn't have given us that hard time, we should have published it more quickly. Others who say it shouldn't have been published at all. What we did get out of it was another addition to our regulations, and this one came out in December of 2012, and it was focused just on H5N1, on gain-of-function research. This was guidance from the government. I think it came up through the White House and then was published via NIH. There were two points in here that I think we couldn't implement. Number two says, in order to do this kind of research, if you want to do something, it has to not intend nor be reasonably anticipated to yield a high path H5N1 experimental virus that has increased transmissibility, pathogenicity, or expanded host range, unless there is evidence that such a virus could be produced through natural evolutionary processes in the near future. We can't know that. You just can't know that. It's possible it might be produced in the near future or in the distant future, but you can't know it. So I think that requirement didn't make sense. This one didn't either. Biosecurity risk can be sufficiently mitigated and managed. I know how to manage biosafety risks. I don't know how to manage biosecurity risks. So I thought it was a little sloppy in the way it was done, but that's really what spun out of all those discussions with Yoshi. And then I think we were at that point, I know in my own mind, I started thinking a lot more about security and safety and less about security. just as sort of a transition point there. I won't take the time to go through this, but my concern at the time, are we simply going to regulate this away? I said, this has been a tactical challenge dealing with these two manuscripts. I think we're going to have a strategic challenge. We're going to expect future surprises. We must work together globally. And hopefully, we won't just try to regulate these things away. Then, a paper that was sort of under the radar that not a lot of people talk about occurred in April of 2014. And this was actually came out of University of Maryland and Virginia Maryland Veterinary College, where they took H7N9, a different virus, put it in ferrets and just passaged it, gave it to one ferret, took probably a swab from that one after he was sick, gave it to another one, continued to passage it for 10 passages, and it became transmissible. So you didn't need a molecular biology lab or virology lab. All you need is a cave to do this study. And I found that pretty scary, that was possible, to produce a mammalian transmissible respiratory H7, not an H5, but a virus that hadn't been transmissible by the respiratory route, just by passage. You know, this is one, I think, a good sort of thought exercise. Should it have been done? It gave us a better understanding of the virus. It was conducted in an ABSL3, and I think safety risks were managed quite well in this case. It started with a non-human strain, which was really smart. This is an ostrich virus, and it was also sensitive to oseltamivir, the antiviral. So they were thoughtful in the way they did it, and yet just knowing that can be done, I mean, a lot of viruses would say it can probably be done, but here they proved it, that just passaging without really any specially, it could be done without any special equipment. But so cons, gain of function just through passage, no loss of virulence with gain of transmissibility. There was some question in the H5 studies that Ron and Yoshi did that there was some virulence lost. Knowledge could aid non-technical malevolence. Passage was in a non-natural host, so it was artificial. So what does it mean? And an unknown community risk. What happens if that gets away? So this was another example that was done, and I don't know where the approval for that study actually occurred, maybe just at the university level. Then we started getting some noises from a senior group of people. It was called the Cambridge Working Group. This is Cambridge, Massachusetts, not Cambridge, England. A bunch of very senior virologists who said, there's an urgent need for thorough reassessment of biosafety. For any experiment, the expected net benefits should outweigh the risks. And then they expanded on that a little bit, but that was essentially their point. That was July of 04. Then also in July of 2014, we had a couple of safety lapses at CDC, and you probably saw these. Those were in the paper. There was one in which they believe some workers within the CDC were exposed to some anthrax spores. No one became ill. Some of them were put on antibiotics. The one that disturbed me more was this bird flu incident. They had virulent H5 at the CDC in Atlanta. They inactivated, I don't know what method they used, and sent it to David Swain's lab, which is a USDA lab in Georgia, the National Poultry Laboratory. And when it got there, David found out that it was virulent. It was very much like what happened at Dugway some months ago. It hadn't been irradiated. But what disturbed me most, and I'm interested in leadership, was Tom Frieden said it occurred 6 weeks ago, but was not reported to the senior agency leadership. It took 6 weeks for bad news to get up the chain to the boss. That's just unacceptable, in my opinion. When I'm responsible for an organization, I care much less about good news. I really want to know about bad news, and I want to know it before anybody else does, if possible, so you can deal with it and assure that it's appropriately dealt with. And I thought that was disappointing to see that happen, because leaders have got to take responsibility. He also said he's angry, he's lost sleep. Staff members who failed will be disciplined. That's his own business. He can do that behind closed doors, but he's responsible. The buck needs to stop with the boss in these organizations, and it's not happening very much in these countries, in this country anymore. Then in October, same year, 2014, White House halts research on MERS, SARS, and influenza. And the influenza, for example, is casting a pretty wide net. It's not just H5. It's a lot of different of the flu strains. MERS as well is one that, if you look into it, Mideast Respiratory Syndrome, if you look into it carefully, we really need to do some gain-of-function work on that one. There's no animal model for it, for example. And I know Ralph Barrick down in North Carolina was on the verge and has been developing animal models for MERS, and a lot of his work has been shut down. And there's a lot of similar viruses out in bats now, around, that have been found in bats as well. And I think we're vulnerable. And we need to really be careful that as we shut down this gain-of-function work, and there's some that probably needed to be shut down, we need to be careful that we don't throw the good stuff that can be done safely out with that is considered too high risk. There is an example, and not many of these published, but there are some examples of individuals who have responded to what they perceived as risks and dealt with them very carefully. Steve Arnon, who's a bot toxinologist, a clinician who treats infant bot in children in California State Public Health of California, discovered a new toxin, an eighth serotype of bot, he believed. No therapy or vaccine. He doesn't publish his data. He consults authorities. He triggers work toward therapy at Scripps. They started making monoclonal antibodies. And then he publishes, but he controls the strain until he could be assured that this couldn't be misused or that there was a countermeasure available. Some people have said Steve overreacted a little bit. This may not be as dangerous as what was originally thought, but I think that's okay, because he was at least thoughtful and he was trying to be responsible in this case. A lot of that goes on, I think, but we don't hear about it all the time. Dave Relman, a friend of mine from Stanford, published a paper on this, and I'm sure you have access to that paper, Inconvenient Truths in the Pursuit of Scientific Knowledge in Public Health. And he told about this Corson report that was written in the 80s, in which the president emeritus of Cornell proposed how to deal with this kind of a problem. And he said, if research is being done, and he wasn't thinking about the kind of biology we are at that time, but he said, if it's being done, for example, in a university or in an academic setting, research with dual use or military applications, research with a short time to such applications, research when dissemination could give short-term advantage to adversaries, again, this is Cold War era thinking, research when the information was believed not to be already held by the adversaries, he proposed that voluntary pre-publication control exercised by the investigator. I think that's easier to do in 1980 than it is today. Postdocs are out talking about their research. It's often out long before it's published. And it's just a completely different time. But it's interesting that someone has thought about this in the past, and this is one example. And he called it the Corson gray area between classified and unclassified. I found it interesting that David came up with that discussion. So then we're now in April 3 of 2015, and we start hearing about CRISPR, Have you all heard about CRISPR? Or you know what CRISPR is? This is not testable, but it's clustered regulatory interspace short paleodromic repeats.
I couldn't have done that.
No, it's written up there. It's a tool that can be used to change the germline. I'm just, as I said, back from China, and we were there for a two-day different meeting, but we had a one-day meeting ahead of that with the Chinese Academy, and we had some plant scientists there. They've been using CRISPR very successfully to change lines of wheat, germ line in wheat, to produce wheat hybrids and things like that. But you could do the same thing in animals, or you could do the same thing in people. And so these guys, including some Nobel laureates, came out in April of this year and said, we need to be careful before we start using this tool. And it is being used, but it hadn't been used for human embryos. We discourage germline genome modification for clinical application in humans while implications of such activity are being discussed. And see, what you could do if you have a genetic predisposition to some bad disease and you don't want your children to have that, you could have your germline change of the, you could produce an embryo and change the DNA of that embryo before the baby's developed, and in theory, that child would not be susceptible to the same heritable disease that had been passed down in your family for many generations. That's the upside. Anybody ever seen this movie? Really? We watched it just because of, I had to give a talk about this one time, so we found it on Amazon, but I'd never heard of it. But here's, it's very much like what you can do with CRISPR. Nearly everyone was genetically altered, their DNA adjusted to prevent disease, enhance intelligence, and make them look good. So that's what you could do, in theory, with this genetic tool. And that was 18 years ago. They were even ahead of us. Then the Chinese did it. With human embryos, I think it was 85 human embryos that they tried it with, but they then killed the embryos. They didn't let them live. And it turns out that, I think I have a slide, I don't have the details. They did 85 embryos, it worked in four of them. There were other changes that occurred in some of the others in the germline, and there were yet other unexpected changes completely off track from what they originally had been trying to do. And so these Chinese scientists said, our study underscores the challenges facing clinical application of CRISPR-Cas9. Further investigation of the molecular mechanisms of CRISPR-mediated gene editing in human model is sorely needed, in particularly off-target effects, because they saw a lot of off-target effects. They should be investigated thoroughly before any clinical application. Taken together, our work highlights the pressing need to improve the fidelity and specificity of CRISPR-Cas9 platform, a prerequisite for any clinical applications. There was a study, and if you're interested in gain of function in particular for any reason, you can get it on the National Academy Press website. This was held in December of 14, and it was sort of a stream of consciousness, 150 really good scientists and political scientists, and they discussed should this be done and so on, discussed various factors, risk benefit, measuring risk, and so on. And I just pulled two slides, I had to give a talk on that in China, and I pulled two slides out, and Ron Atlas, former president of ASM, said, because it is not possible to assess what breakthroughs may occur as a result of fundamental research, including gain of function, it is impossible to quantify the benefits of gain of function research for a risk-benefit analysis. We can't know the benefits. Long-term benefits are achievable, but it's not possible to specify what these are when the research is being done. And with regard to gain of function in viruses, David Relman again said, viruses with increased virulence, transmissibility, and pathogenicity would clearly define a line that would prompt the use of alternatives. In other words, he's saying, if you're doing all those three things, produce a virus that results in all those three things, you probably shouldn't do it. It's probably too dangerous to do. Like if you made a filovirus virus transmissible by the respiratory route, it's already virulent, it's already highly pathogenic. If you added respiratory transmissibility, that would really be a bad thing. So that would be a black line for gain of function. Then, moving on with history, in May, we think one technician, human error, virulent anthrax spores, not many, not a large, very small percentage in each vial, but mailed to laboratories all over this country and even one in Seoul. Shouldn't happen. And it's all about safety now. We're not talking much about security with regard to this now. We're talking about safety. I was disappointed in the senior leadership in DOD when General Odierno, who just retired as the chief of staff, said human error on the news. Human error was not a fact, probably was not a factor. Oh, come on. These things don't happen by themselves. I thought that was kind of a weak comment. And then the secretary, who I have an enormous amount of respect for and know fairly well from serving on committees with him in the past, said, "We will make sure that any public health consequences of this are avoided. I don't know how. And what's even worse, we will ensure that it never happens again." That's impossible. I think someone was feeding him information to tell a reporter. And I know he was busy. He was overseas, as he's been traveling a lot. And he's always busy, and he's got a lot bigger things on his mind. But we can't assure that it will never happen again. As long as there are humans involved doing research in laboratories, there are going to be accidents. We haven't had many accidents. We were talking before some of you came in our DOD programs, three people have died, all of those before 1969 when we still had an offensive program, two anthrax and one Bolivian hemorrhagic fever. We haven't had accidents in our laboratory. We've had little accidents, animal bites, needle sticks, bone fragments through gloves, but nobody's died for the many years that we've been doing this kind of work with these kinds of agents. But we can't ensure that it will never happen again. And then another, I don't know where they get this, Pentagon blames anthrax fiasco on no one at all. But it, and then the next thing that happened in September was because of the accidents, or the, they weren't accidents, because of the mailings of virulent materials out of Dugway, it prompted the Pentagon to freeze operations at 9 biodefense laboratory that work with dangerous viruses. I've talked only to people at USAMRIID, and it wasn't a complete shutdown, but I know one of the things they had to do was look through all their stocks and see whether there was anything labeled virulent that wasn't avirulent that wasn't virulent or something. I don't know how you do that, with viruses particularly, if you have to grow them up in cell culture. But that was the solution to this problem. And I haven't heard much about it since then. So what we've seen as we've looked at this history is Larry Wayne Harris gave us the select agent rule. The anthrax letters gave us the USA Patriot Act and Army Regulation 50-1. H5N1 gave us a new policy for oversight of dual-use research. Gain-of-function work continues to some degree, but it goes on. But then after the CDC safety lapses, the White House steps in and stops the gain-of-function research. So how can we deal with this? Regulation for security, as we're kind of wrapping up here. What and how much is always the issue with regard to regulation. We have to have regulation. You have to have just like in a football game, you have to know what the boundaries are, you have to know what the rules are. You have to have that any kind of a dangerous operation, I believe. Some of the issues are these personnel reliability programs are U.S.-centered, and also the bioselect agents are found globally. Tracking individual pathogens is impossible. We try to do that with new radiologic materials, but we only have like 3 isotopes to worry about, and we have tools to measure whether they're there or not. New technologies make these pathogen lists obsolete, I think, will eventually, certainly. And new technologies are not on the list. It's so different than nuclear. We often tried to put nuclear solutions on biological problems. Biology, it's wide open and probably not controlled or even controllable by international norms, for example. The BWC is important. It's an international norm and it's a law and we should respect it. But it doesn't help very much in these kinds of challenges. The bugs are everywhere. I don't know if you've, most of you probably know Gigi Granwell Quick, or Gigi Quick Granwell. She did this really nice paper. These are all our select agents. This is a map of the world. There's Australia, there's Alaska. And between January of 2009 and October of 2010, these were all the outbreaks that occurred with select agents. So they're available. You know, they're not all locked up in laboratories. That shows you how many occurred just to those select agents. We were in, this is outside Bangkok, and these are fruit bats, and this young scientist named Chu spreads tablecloths out under the bats because they roost there during the day. They go out and feed on fruit at night, and they're bat guano drops, and they're seropositive for Nipah every day, Nipah virus. And she occasionally can isolate virus, live virus out of that, just from catching it on a tablecloth. And yet, there were about 2 kilometers away, she took us to a pig farm, and they've not had any Nipah in pigs. This is the one that killed pigs and people in Malaysia in late 90s or early 2000s, something like that. But, you know, these virus, bats are famous for carrying bad things, and that's one of them. Select agent regulations, they were developed for security. We originally developed select agent regulations because of Larry Wayne Harris and the anthrax regulations. They've totally become safety related now, and there's a huge bureaucracy that's built up around them. I just wrote a paper, you probably all read Health Security Journal from UPMC. And I just wrote a paper on the implementation. I think the select agent rules are about right, the rules, but there's a huge bureaucracy that's built up around them now that is really slowing science in laboratories. And that paper's available if you're ever interested. So what can we do? We can't lock up the bugs. We can't control the equipment technology. We can't control the knowledge. We can't isolate scientists. We can't know all the biohackers. We can build awareness and educate, like the Fink report suggested. We can, and I think we've done quite a bit of that. We can seek to communicate and build trust in these communities around biological research. We can use the good that comes out of biological research to counter the harm. We can apply leadership principles on our labs. I don't think we've done that effectively. We can impact the culture of our laboratories, and I think we've gone the other way with regard to culture in the labs that I'm close to, at least, and those are primarily DOD labs. I think academic labs where they can select their leaders are a different story in some cases. Wonderful lab down in Galveston, UTMB at Galveston, that's run by Jim LeDuc and Tom Kaizak. They're not micromanaged like the government labs are, but for example, all the select agent rules apply to them as well, and all the bureaucracy that's grown up around those apply to them and impact them as well. We can't afford to overregulate. I think the turnaround time to know that we've overregulated is long. I think it could take us 5 to 10 years to know that we have, and 15 to 20 years to turn it around. And one of my big concerns, and I hear it when I visit laboratories, is that scientists are saying, that young scientists will say, it's just too hard. I'll go into policy, or I'll become a lawyer, or I'll become something else. It's just too hard to do research, basic bench research anymore today. Actually, I was giving a talk at the law school at St. Louis University, and the dean had just introduced me, and I was giving a talk, and I got to this kind of point in the, and I said, you know, these scientists who would have been biologists now might just go off and be, and he said, were you going to say lawyers? And I said, yes, I'm sorry. But, you know, it's easier to be a lawyer than to be a scientist today. You don't have as many regulations. You can write regulations, maybe. But I'm really concerned about that because it could have an impact on all these things that I mentioned, including our national security. Thoughts on the way ahead? I covered it up, I guess. But demonstrate that we, you know, demonstrate that we deserve the trust of the community is a big one. Someone else mentioned that earlier as we were talking before class. And build relationships with the community that regulates and build help them understand the cost and the value of regulation. There is a cost to it as well. There is often a value, but there's almost always a cost. One of the ones that I used when I was running a laboratory were I tried to think about seek solutions that won't frustrate the scientists. Because they're why we're there. It's not the boss isn't why that lab exists. It's because of the scientists. And my job, I used to say, was to feed them beans and bullets so they could get their work done and fight the infectious disease battle. But try to find solutions that don't frustrate them. A book that some of you may have seen, Greg knows about it, I know, and written by a good friend, Kendall Hoyt from Dartmouth. She asked me to read The Galleys, and I did. And what I took out of it on a quick read was, thesis was, her question was, why could the U.S. government produce vaccines in the 40s, 50s, and 60s, and why is it so hard for us to get them out of the door and into people's arms in the 70s, 80s, and 90s, and into the next century? And what I took out on the quick read was, one, in the old days there was a champion who would grab onto an antigen candidate and just take it all the way until it was in produced, advanced development, produced, tested, and in the arms of people. Like Maurice Hilleman, who I mentioned at Merck earlier in the talk. And the second one, really important, was communities of trust. A lot of these old timers came out of Walter Reed Army Institute of Research during World War II, where they were developing vaccines and countermeasures for soldiers. They went off after the war into industry, to Merck and to Pfizer, and one might call the other one at another industrial facility and say, what was that cell line we used for that virus again? I've forgotten. And they would actually tell them. They didn't have to work through a group of lawyers in order to transmit information, and that's the way it is today. I've spent some time talking to the people at BARDA in HHS whose job it is to do this, and they're just lawyers everywhere. And so those communities of trust that we used to have in science, it's not that the trust has broken down to being science, but we've put bureaucracy in between them. And I think I expected when she said she was going to write this book that it was because of regulation. And it turned that we have more regulation now. Even though we have more technology, more regulation has damped down our productivity. She said that wasn't it. It was these two points that made the bigger difference. So how do you develop trust? Great book by Stephen Covey Jr., the father of the Covey that wrote Eight Habits of Highly Successful People or something, or Seven Habits or something. The Speed of Trust, a little-known book, and I just ran across it a couple of years ago, and he talks about the difference in a high-trust organization and a low-trust organization. And you can see that Wouldn't you rather have increased value, growth, innovation, collaboration, partnering, execution, and loyalty? I believe that leadership in an organization can make that kind of difference. And these are just sort of my thoughts with regard to what enlightened leadership is. You lead with science, quality, safety, vision, education, responsibility, accountability, honesty, transparency, and ethics. I think that can produce a culture of trust. The far other end of that spectrum is leading with security, guns, gates, and guards, background checks, psychological evaluations. We will have to do this at some laboratories. My old lab has all that now. But it needs all of this as well. I think every laboratory needs this. Some laboratories also need that. But you can overcome a culture of mistrust. This side is more powerful than this side. It might make inconvenience, it might inconvenience the scientists, but you can overcome that with the kind of leadership that's listed on the left side. And I think that kind of a culture is safer and more secure, and I know it's more productive as well. Just along that line, Jim LaDuke, who actually runs that Galveston lab that I talked about, and I did this. We were talking about our approach to the insider threat, saying that kind of culture on that last slide can make a laboratory more secure, but I think it applies to safety as well. Particularly if the boss says, safety is important to me, and the implementer of a safety program is the kind I talked about before, that says, how can we work together to make to make you successful in your laboratory research? Another anecdote, we were sitting in Casablanca talking about safety training for laboratories. You know, our government has sent all kinds of people out, contractors and government folks, to do safety training and security training in laboratories, and then the result is you get a certificate on the wall. It's usually not that fancy, but that's sort of the goal of this process. And we were talking about, is that enough, or how does it work, working, and so on. And there was an engineer sitting over on my left, way over there, and all of a sudden he said, it's got to be in the soup. It's got to be in the soup. And we said, what? What do you mean it's got to be in the soup? And then he explained, and he said, safety and security is not why we exist in our laboratories, but if you don't have it, you're not going to be successful. You've got to have it, and it's got to be in your culture. It's got to be in your culture. So this was right before lunch, and I got on my laptop over lunch and made this slide. Not quite this fancy, but I roughed it out. And then later we worked together and we made it. So I might be doing fundamental research. I might be doing developing and testing. I might be doing translation of science. And my purpose might be any of these black things over here. I might be making energy, doing agricultural, public health, which is what most of us think of, food, environment, whatever. That's why I'm there. These are the products that I want to come out of my laboratory. In order to do that, you need infrastructure, the black stuff, patent law, marketing, animal and human use, legal frameworks, risk assessment, finance, technology, management, safety, security. Those are part of that infrastructure that you need. You need leadership, which can give you ethics, strategy, collaboration, vision, honesty, individual responsibility. And the cultural outcomes of that kind of leadership can be partnering, quality, value and values, growth, corporate responsibility, innovation, and so on. And you need that kind of an operation rather than a certificate on the wall to make safety and security part of the program, and it will be much more effective than if you just pull out your safety officers and send them to a course and they get a certificate on the wall. It's got to be part of the culture. And that's something that's, it's hard to implement, it's hard to scale, and our government, I don't think, has done a great job of it. There is a good example from industry, and I'm almost through here. Paul O'Neill was, in 1987, became the CEO of Alcoa Aluminum, and they were having a lot of safety problems in the company. It's a very dangerous place to work, big molten pots of metal, as you can imagine. He, in his first talk to the shareholders, said that he is going to talk about worker safety. And this was to the shareholders, not to the staff of the company. And shareholders didn't like it. Some of them, I'm told, got up and walked out. Some of them said they were going to sell their shares in Alcoa if he was focused on worker safety. They wanted him to focus on the bottom line. Are we going to make more money or not? Are we going to be more productive? And he said, I'm not certain you heard me. If you want to understand how Alcoa is doing, you need to look at the workplace safety figures. They were bad. If we bring injury rates down, it won't be because of cheerleading or nonsense you sometimes hear from other CEOs. It will be because individuals at this company have agreed to become part of something important. And that's the kind of approach that I'm talking about with regard to real leadership that can make a difference in an organization with regard to safety. There aren't many like this, but this is one example. If you look at his record, here's where he took the job, and that's just thought quotes. That's where he left after 14 years, Both their market value of the company and the net income increased 7 to 8-fold in the time that he was a CEO. And if you look at their website today, he's left that legacy of safety. They actually, where's their homepage anyway? Probably someplace. But there's a safety tab that you can click on the homepage of their website, and they're still talking about this X number of years after he left. And it actually made a huge difference in profitability because it changed a culture in that organization. He wrote a book about it. So safety is not why we're here. Whether it's a result of accidents or dual use issues that we talked about or gain of function issues that we talked about, safety isn't our product. But if we don't have it in our organizations, we're not going to have a product. So it's critically important. We need guidelines and regulations, but we've got to have the right culture. And the beauty of this is each of us can make a difference. We can all be leaders no matter what level, whether we're the big boss or the middle boss or just running a lab or running some small technical piece of a lab. Each of us must take personal responsibility, and out of that can come corporate responsibility. And we've got to be productive in this business. We can't. You saw that initial line where I showed where I think productivity is coming down in our labs in this country. We've got to be productive because the world needs us. These are just some examples: Ebola, MERS, H5, and one of the other flus probably. But it's critical that we get this sorted out. We've got to pay attention, we've got to have regulations, we've got to be safe, but we've also got to be productive. So I'll stop with that.